Our friend Jane is paying bills for the month and realizes finances felt a little tighter than usual. Reviewing her bank activity, she sees all sorts of strange transactions she doesn't recall making. Uh-oh, how did this happen? Welcome to Once Upon an Attack, a web series by the Splunk Education team in which we learn about common cybersecurity threats and attacks. Today in We Are All Targets, we'll talk about email phishing campaigns. While there are different categories of phishing, at its core, phishing is a type of social engineering attack in which malicious actors attempt to trick users to perform some action or share private information via phone, text, or email. Our story today focuses on mass email phishing campaigns, but the lessons we learn can apply to other types of malicious campaigns too. Let's dive right in. In order to launch a mass email phishing campaign, an attacker needs to get valid emails to try and phish, basically the targets. To gather these, attackers could find datasets shared by cybercriminal groups. But those lists may be overused or lack quality control to make them worthwhile. Attackers could instead buy a list of valid emails from other attackers selling through the dark web. Some of these lists may even include other useful personal information tied to the account, like where the user lives. Lastly, they can build their own email list by scraping personal emails from social media, forms, public records, or websites that don't hide emails very well. Once they have their targets, they will need somewhere to send the phishing emails from. Many email providers have whole security teams dedicated to prevent malicious use of their service. So attackers often need fresh bases of operation to send out their emails without getting caught by automated detection, spam filters, and block lists. Attackers may try creating multiple users on a service, using automation to simulate common user behavior, so it's harder to distinguish them from legitimate new accounts. Another method is to leverage the cybercriminal market on the dark web, where someone may be selling access to recently compromised email accounts, which have never sent spam email. This gives them extra time to send lots of emails before getting shut down or filtered. Now that our threat actors have targets and accounts to send email from, the next step is to decide, what are they sending? How are they going to lure their targets into their trap? In this scenario, our attacker wants to acquire user credentials that they can later use to earn money. So they will buy or build phishing kits, which can include scripts, plug-and-play web pages, and email templates that mimic the online service they want to access, which makes the phishing emails more convincing. The phishing emails are the bait for the targets. A user will get an email, maybe matching their bank's emails, telling them that there's a problem with their account and they need to quickly click on this link and type in their username and password. From there, the attacker will collect them. It used to be much easier to spot errors in grammar and design that helped us identify fake emails, but we are already seeing attackers use tools that rely on artificial intelligence to craft phishing messages which appear more legitimate. When a user falls for the scam and clicks the link, they are redirected to the credential phishing website, which can be hosted in a few different places. Sometimes, threat actors will scan the internet for websites with security vulnerabilities they can easily exploit, allowing them to post their phishing kit into a secret URL that the website owner may never find out about. This is why a user might find a fake login page to their bank hosted on grandpacookies.com, and why the owners suddenly find out they can't sell cookies because their website has been categorized as phishing and blocked by popular proxy services. They can also hide their phishing kit in plain sight. For example, an attacker may purchase cloud hosting services and take advantage of them until they are caught. Since the infrastructure will be shared with other legitimate websites, the time it takes to identify malicious ones and blocking them might be just enough to make the investment worth it. regardless of whether they buy or build their own, automation and repeatability are needed so that an operation can be easily moved or launched from another location. Now our attacker has everything they need to launch their phishing campaign. A list of targets, the infrastructure to send email, the phishing bait, and a credential phishing page. They just need to be careful about how often emails are sent to avoid raising suspicion and getting shut down too quickly. If they are good at hiding or obfuscating their activities, or if they have a lot of infrastructure to rotate between, this campaign could run for weeks or months before their operation goes stale. Because they're sending out thousands and thousands of emails, they can gather a decent amount of credentials, even if they're only able to deceive a very small percentage of the users they target. Once they've acquired credentials, how can they exploit them? They can try credential stuffing. This means they take a username and password combination from one place, then try these credentials against all sorts of popular services, primarily email, banking, and online shopping, expanding the reach of one stolen credential to multiple accounts. If an attacker is able to tie information, like a country a target lives in, to their list of email addresses, they can even utilize a virtual private network, or VPN, to simulate login attempts from their original location to avoid raising login location alarms. Once they take over an account, if they get access to financial accounts paired with other information they find out about their target, they could set up wire transfers. If they get access to shopping logins, they can buy gift cards or other non-physical and hard-to-track goods that they can later profit from, like it happened to Jane from the beginning of our story. They can also use unsuspecting people looking for work by offering them cash in exchange for receiving and resending packages on their behalf, giving the attacker an extra hop to their ultimate destination in an attempt to evade the authorities. But the most valuable account they could get access to is your email, because it can give them a glimpse of all the other services that you use. Access to your authentication codes for those accounts, access to your contact list, and also gives them the ability to hide or delete security alerts before you even see them. I bet you'll be paying more attention to your email and avoid reusing passwords from now on, right? But don't worry, you are not alone in the defense lines. Most companies are aware that they and their customers are potential targets of fraud, credential stuffing, and account takeover. So they will offer features like multi-factor authentication to help protect their accounts. They will also have tools and policies in place to detect and ban suspicious behavior. For example, detecting and blocking a single IP address trying to log into multiple accounts or consistently failing password checks. Every time an attacker's infrastructure is detected and blocked, and every time we thwart their attempts to use the credentials they've gathered, our defense inflicts a cost that adds up until they decide it's time to move on. They can decide to pivot to another phishing kit or infrastructure. Or they can decide it's not worth the risk or time to actually use the credentials, and instead bundle them up and sell them to other cybercriminals who might want to try their luck. And the cycle begins again. Phishing is still happening and will continue to happen because it is profitable. So while attackers continue to find new ways to profit from scams, we will continue to raise awareness amongst users and strengthen our defense to protect them and our assets. As users and as defenders, we may only see a small part of the whole operation, but understanding the bigger picture of campaigns and how attackers can use the credentials they steal will help us be better prepared against these and other attacks. Thanks for taking the bait and watching this episode of Once Upon an Attack from our Blue Team Academy Cybersecurity Defense Analyst Program. To learn more about how Splunk can support your efforts against these and other cybersecurity threats, visit the links in the description. For getting started guides and product tips, please visit Splunk Lantern. We also suggest you check out the documentation, watch additional videos on the Splunk How-To channel, and register for courses from Splunk Education. Thanks for watching.